The rain is pounding against my window. It always seems to rain more frequently now that I'm retired. In my favorite chair, I look at an old photo from my days with the Rangers. I can still remember when the coffee stain in the corner occurred. O'Brien, the red-haired guy to the right of the picture, accidentally pushed me while we were playing around in the barracks. I never bothered to clean up the stain, and now I'm happy I didn't. It gives the picture a certain character, don't you think? And it reminds me of O'Brien. O'Brien is the guy smiling with his whole face. Next to him stands Dutch, who has a tribal tattoo on his right arm. The guy holding the rifle is Louis. I don't blame you if you mistake him for being the youngest of us. He always looked young for his age. A flash of lightning illuminates my living room, and for a moment, it looks just like one of the rooms in the compound in Barak. Are you sure about this, Captain? The words of O'Brien still replay in my head. I remember us standing in the pouring rain, in mud that came up to our knees. Orders are orders, O'Brien, I had said, but I had my doubts. The weather felt wrong. Everything felt wrong about that place. I put the picture down on the table next to me and closed my eyes. I could hear Major Gallagher's voice in my mind, giving the mission briefing. Miller, I need you to extract someone and interview them. You'll be speaking with a man named Mohammed Rashid, who has intel on local insurgent activity. Just bring him in, do the interview, and let him go. Easy peasy. That mission had been anything but normal, though. A loud crack of thunder startled me just then, and I jumped in my seat. The rain began to come down even harder, and I found myself staring out the window again, thinking about that strange place where it all began, that village in Barak. But I didn't want to think about that, since it always gave me nightmares, and I had a hard enough time sleeping, as it was. I grabbed my notebook from the drawer at my desk and opened it up to a blank page. It was time to write down everything that happened, I told myself. Maybe it would help me work through it all. Tom, he said, I saw it again, in the doorway, the way it was moving. I scribbled down the following. Barak incident, April 15th, 2011. Rainfall, unusual. Team, Miller, CO, O'Brien, Dutch, Lewis. Contact, Mohammed Rashid. I can see it even as I write this, like the air is blurry around the words, the way it was blurry the night we went to Rashid's compound. Sir, Lewis had said quietly, I think the thermal scanner is picking up something that shouldn't be there. I stopped myself. I remember how the thermal scope had shown human-shaped heat signatures walking through the walls, dividing into more, and then merging again. Louis switched it off and on three times before I told him to stop. The lamp is flickering again, and I think I see something moving in the corner of my eye. But it's just the shadow of a tree branch, thrown against the wall by another flash of lightning. Isn't it? That's what we told ourselves in Barak, too. I need to keep writing this down. I have to keep writing. Mohammed Rashid, when we found him, his hands were shaking. Shaking not because of us, but because of something else. The symbols on his doorframe, the carvings. They said that no one could translate them. They said, they come with the rain. A text alert goes off on my phone. I pick it up. It's a message from Major Gallagher. We need to talk about Barak. Things are happening again. I read the message again, listening to the rain. It sounds as if it's coming down harder now, and it has a strange rhythm to it, almost like words. I look at the picture of us again, so young and innocent, and I think about what we saw in that village. Maybe this time, if I write it all down, it'll make sense. Maybe this time, someone will believe us. Maybe this time, it will change the outcome. Because if Gallagher is right, if things are happening again. I look out the window, and for a split second, I see the rain falling upward, just like in Barak, just like before. The lamp flickers again, and I write faster. The storm rages through the night, and I find myself drifting between memories and reality. Sleep won't come. Not with these thoughts. Not with this rain. As morning breaks, the downpour hasn't let up. If anything, it's grown stronger. The steady drumming against my roof transforms into a roar that pulls me back, dragging me deep into memories I've tried so hard to forget. Suddenly, I'm not at my study anymore, but back there, boots sinking into mud, surrounded by the familiar faces of my unit. The rain feels the same, but this time I know what's coming. As I'm writing this down, I can hear the rain pouring down outside of my window. It reminds me of the time I was there. I can still see it clearly in front of me, and I have to stop writing for a moment to catch my breath. We were walking around on patrol in the middle of the rain. "Captain, things are getting really bad out here," O'Brien said, his vibrant red hair now sticking dark to his head. "We might want to retreat to the higher floor." I opened my mouth to answer, but then I heard the first scream. "Where?" I shouted, already looking at the nearest mud brick structures. "That way," Luis responded, gesturing with his rifle. 100 meters northeast." Dutch emerged from the river, water pouring off him in sheets. "I saw a bunch of houses in that direction, Captain." "Farmhouses." I followed the others, moving in the same direction, and found myself in knee-deep water. It was cold and had a strange, brassy scent. "Structure at 2 o'clock, half underwater." In the distance, I could see a mud brick house that was half underwater, with 3 people on top of it. "O'Brien, Dutch, clear a route. Louis, watch our backs. Go." The water made it difficult to move. We reached the building as another part of the wall came crashing down. "Boss, it's a family," Dutch said, sounding stressed. "Dad, 2 little girls. The man was holding his daughters tightly in his arms. They were soaking wet and appeared terrified. "Tell them we're here to help," I said in simple Pashto. "Underscore we help. Safe place. You know." O'Brien stepped up to take the girl. At first, Karim hesitated. He looked back, not towards us, but towards the water. He waved his hand and said something I didn't understand. "Hey, Mr. B," Louis said. "There's something out in the field." I looked over and saw nothing but rain, although it did look like it was moving strangely, and the smell of metal was even more pronounced now, mixed with something else. "Let's just get these people out of here," I said angrily, trying to quell the fear. "Dutch, you're on point. O'Brien, grab the girls. Louise, cover us." We helped the girls across the water, making sure they were safely passed to each of us. Their dad climbed across next, still pointing towards the fields and yelling frantically. "Underscore Shaitan underscore," he kept repeating. "Underscore Shaitan Dardasht Ast." The rain was coming down harder now, and it was beginning to hurt. Captain, O'Brien's voice was a bit shaky. "The water's filling up too quickly." He was right. The water had actually risen a foot already in the time since we had found the family. That wasn't possible, I realized. "Get moving. Move, move, move." We dragged them, fighting against the water, and slowly but steadily we made our way down the road. The 2 girls cried, but the father had become silent, as if he had seen something we hadn't. Louis, who was behind me, came to a stop. Sir, the thermal is showing. Oh my God. Louis, get over here, I shouted at him, but he didn't budge, still looking through his scope. The signatures, they're walking through the walls. They're separating, and that's not possible. There was a noise then. It was a strange, distant sound, like thunder, but not quite like thunder. Dutch, get them to the vehicle. O'Brien, suppressing fire. Louis, what the fuck are you doing? We got to higher ground just as the water was flooding the last buildings in town. The family hopped into the back of our vehicle, wet and shivering, but otherwise unharmed. I was just about to leave when Karim stopped me. Underscore tomorrow is too late, underscore, he said again, staring at me. Underscore they come with rain. Always with rain. I wanted to tell myself he was just crazy, but the terrified look in his eyes reminded me of the way Mohammed Rashid would look at me later on. Hey, boss, Dutch said behind me. It's coming. The rain continued to pour down, although it now seemed to have a will of its own. I told my crew to leave the village and return the next day when the water levels had decreased, but we never got the chance to go back. The next day, the entire village was gone. Not destroyed, not abandoned, but gone. A loud rumble brings me back to the present. It's thundering outside, and for a moment I think I hear it again. My phone vibrates again. Another message from Gallagher. They found another village, Tom, just like Barak, just like that day. I don't think I'll be able to sleep tonight, so I might as well jot down a few more thoughts. It's still raining outside, and I can hear a low rumbling noise in the distance, possibly thunder. The night dragged on endlessly as I sat at my desk, listening to the persistent rain and writing until my hand cramped. Around dawn, the downpour softened to a steady drizzle, but that metallic tang in the air made my stomach turn. I must have dozed off briefly because when I opened my eyes, the first weak rays of morning light were filtering through my window, casting shadows across my notes. The sun is coming up, and I haven't slept. Kareem said, underscore tomorrow is too late, underscore. It is still raining, but the air smells like something metallic. Morning, Captain, says O'Brien. Dutch and Lewis are ready. Aye. What about the village? No update from them. The interference from last night is still in effect. We put on our vests and joined Dutch and Louis, who were waiting by the transport. Light and quick, gentlemen, I say. This is a scouting mission. The moment anything feels wrong, we come back. Got it? Yes, sir, Dutch says. He's nervous, but ready. Sir, Lewis says, thermal's still messed up. Same strange readings as last night. Leave it off. We'll just use our eyes. The drive to the fields is quiet, except for the sound of the tires splashing through deep puddles. The area is flooded by the rain, and everything looks different. Jesus, O'Brien says as we get off the horse. Look down. The mud looks strange. It was moving even where we hadn't stepped, as if it were alive. The smell of blood was very strong now, mixing with the scent of the soil. Delta formation, I command. 5 meter spacing. Mind your step. We continue on in silence, the ground making a strange sucking noise with each step. The rain drips from our equipment, sliding up and down in a way that defies logic. Sir, Dutch whispers. 3 o'clock. Out in the field. I looked behind me and saw thick stems emerging from the mud, looking like fangs sticking up from the earth. What the fuck are those things? Louis says, bringing his rifle up. Hold to your position, I order, despite the urge to flee. O'Brien, get this on film. He lifts his camera. I can't believe he's actually going to take a picture of this stuff. I can't even begin to call it plants, since it doesn't look like any plant I've ever seen before. Sir, you may want to stand back, Dutch says, but it's too late. Suddenly, something snags my sleeve. One of the barbed stems has sliced through my tactical uniform, leaving a shallow cut on my arm. It stings. Back up, I yell, but I see my team getting the same lacerations on their exposed skin. They're reaching out for us, the things, but there's no breeze. Lewis chokes out a response. Captain, the thermal... They're reading human asterisk, hot asterisk. Return to the shuttle, I say. We're going back. Let's move. We slowly back away, keeping our guns aimed towards the garden. The stems begin to bend in our direction as if they're following us. The rain is picking up again, and I begin to hear that strange, thunderous wind sound again. O'Brien, you managed to get pictures of that? Yeah, sir, but I don't know if they're convincing. We return to the transport and watch the field. The stems had straightened up again, but the pain in our arms told us that it hadn't been a dream. We should call this in, Dutch says at last, whatever the hell it is. I nod, imagining the call I'd soon have to make to command. Luis, I want those thermal results on file. O'Brien, I want those pictures saved. Dutch, help me set up a perimeter. I don't want anyone going near that field until we have a better idea of what we're dealing with. Sir, Luis asks, what if Kareem's right? What if tomorrow's too late, I asked. But nobody had any ideas. We'd never faced anything like this before. Miller, Gallagher's voice comes through the radio. Get your team back to base immediately. We've got reports of similar growth patterns in 3 other locations. And Miller, they're spreading. I had to look back one more time. In the light of morning, I thought I could see the stalks growing taller. It was raining again, and the rain was still talking. And in the distance, I heard that sound again. Go, I say, but it sounds like blood and rain in my mouth. The windshield wipers beat a steady rhythm against the downpour as our convoy makes its way through the pre-dawn darkness. None of us speak during the 30-minute drive. The only sounds are the engine's hum and that persistent rain. Through the rearview mirror, I watch the strange field recede into the darkness until the mist swallows it completely. The drive back to the base seems to take forever. The rain outside the window is mesmerizing. I purposefully try not to stare at it, since it reminds me of those things. We are greeted at the gate by Major Gallagher. He does not look pleased. Office, now, he says, before walking away. I follow him, leaving the rest of them to deal with the paperwork. The smell of coffee and cleaning supplies in the hallway is reassuring, but it only serves to remind me of the blood on my clothes. Tell me everything, Gallagher says, after he shuts the door to his office. Don't skip a single detail. I tell him what we found, how the vegetation was off, and about the thermal readings. And you're positive about the activity? Yes, sir. They reacted to us, intentionally. Gallagher gestures at his monitor, a satellite map. We've received calls from these three locations. He points to the red dots on the screen. In the past 12 hours, all after a rain. There is some kind of commotion outside, and I see a group of villagers approaching the entrance to the base. Sir, a young corporal says, opening the door to my office without knocking. There are civilians asking for emergency refuge. There's something you need to see. We rush to the entrance where we find Mohammed Rashid. His clothes are tattered and covered in blood. He has cuts across his arms and chest, just like we do, but his wounds look deeper. He's trembling and looks at us confused. Underscore al-shaytan min al-sakra underscore, he says again, squeezing my arm. Devil from rocks. It comes. Someone get a medic, Gallagher orders, and a translator. O'Brien is next to me. Sir, those slashes, they look just like what those things did to us. Mohammed is squeezing my arm harder now and speaking in broken English. You see them? The sharp ones? They grow fast, too fast. But worse comes after, the walking ones. The walking ones? Gallagher repeats. Mohammed's eyes roll up into his head and his body convulses. From rocks, like water but not water, takes shapes, takes people. The paramedics try to get him on a stretcher, but he insists on standing, pulling me in towards him, grabbing my arm. Your men, he whispers, the ones who go to look. Tell them no. Tell them stay away from rain. Gallagher's radio crackles. Sir, reconnaissance team Bravo is prepped and ready. I turn to Gallagher. Sir, with respect, we should delay until we understand what we're dealing with. We need eyes on those other locations, Captain. We need to know if this is isolated or spreading. Then let me take my team. We've already encountered these things. We know what to look for. Gallagher shakes his head. Your team stays here. I need your first-hand experience to coordinate our response. Bravo team has the best tracking equipment we've got. The Turquoise Berets, our elite recon unit, are already mounting up when we arrive at the motor pool. The rain has picked up again, pattering on the roofs with more intensity. Major, I say again, Mohammed said something. Noted, Captain. We're not taking orders from civilians. Let's move out. The convoy leaves, driving into the rain. Mohammed's voice plays in my head. Tell them stay away from rain. Underscore, sir, Dutch comes up behind me. The cuts on our arms, they're getting worse. I rolled up my sleeve, making sure it was out of earshot of the others, and saw the red line had spread a little and now looked like the root of a plant, growing beneath my skin. O'Brien and Louis were looking at their wounds as well, and I saw they looked similar. Go to medical, I tell them. I want everything documented, blood tests, tissue samples, Ted. Captain Miller, Gallagher calls out from the yard, there's more civilians coming. I need you and security to figure out what the hell is happening. Something must have scared them enough to make them leave. I nodded, thinking. The rain continued to pour down, and in the distance, I thought I heard that strange sound again. Gallagher's radio went silent for a second, and he looked down at it. No service, he says. Guess it's the storm. But we know it's not the storm, and we know something is out there. Something that can move through walls, split up, and take on different shapes. And we just sent six of our men into its direction. 3 hours crawl by with agonizing slowness as the storm intensifies. The afternoon fades into a premature darkness, bringing with it a suffocating silence. The rain drums against the roof in sheets, but it can't mask the growing sense of dread as our missing team fails to make radio contact. The base has grown quiet as night falls. Aside from the humming of the generators and the sound of the rain, there is very little noise. I've been sitting by the radio, waiting for the signal to return, but so far nothing. The infection from the cut has spread to my elbow. Any luck? O'Brien asks, coming up beside me. He's usually all smiles, but not right now. Nothing but static, I respond, and try another frequency. They should have checked in by now. Dutch is pacing around behind us. Those heat signatures from the last couple of hours, they're on the perimeter sensors now, too. How far out? I ask. Less than 2 kilometers. They don't move like animals. There was no answer. At least, not at first. Then a crackle of static, followed by a voice. Base. Base. This is Bravo team. We need immediate static. I pick up the mic. Bravo team, this is base. Please update your status. More static. Then everywhere. They're coming through the gunfire. A scream. It doesn't sound human. Jesus, O'Brien mutters. Another voice, higher pitched, terrified. Hey, taking Barnes. It's inside his... A sickly wet noise. Then silence. I'm on my feet. Get the trucks loaded up. We're moving out. Sir, Louis says from the door. The major wants to see you in his office. I made my way to the command center. It was pitch black outside. Gallagher was standing up, looking at a screen with thermal imaging. You heard, he says. Yes, sir. I'm rallying my men now. Stand down, Captain. We're sealing the base. But, sir, our men are likely already dead, and if they're not, we will be soon. Firebase Echo is dark. Kareem's village has been deserted. This is spreading. I need your team here to secure our walls. There was another scream, closer this time. We both got up and went to the window. I could see something moving in the forest just beyond the fence, something shimmering and iridescent, like an oil slick. Captain, multiple contacts on the west perimeter. Permission to check it out? Gallagher chews his lip. Granted. But, Miller, if you see anything that matches Mohammed's description, you get the hell out of there, you hear me? I don't even hear the rest of what he says. I'm already sprinting for the motor pool. O'Brien is there, ready to go, with the engine running. Dutch and Lewis jump in the back, guns at the ready. West side, I tell him. Quick and quiet, look for any signs of life. The lights of the Humvee shone on the fence and the vacant space beyond. Vacant, except for the figures which appeared to drift more than walk, their shapes flickering and changing like shadows seen through murky water. What the fuck? Lewis whispers, peering into the thermal scope. How is this possible? The voice on the radio comes through again, stronger this time. Please, anyone. They're not stopping. They look like us, but they're not. Static erupted from the radio once more, along with a sound that might have been laughter, as if something was mocking us. Cut the engine, I say, when we reach the fence, and kill the lights. They're coming closer now. I can almost see the dark shapes of them approaching. There's one that looks like a person. Sir, Duchess is hushed. Their faces. I lift my night vision goggles and see that they have faces. Their faces I recognize. One of them is Barnes from Bravo Team, but his face is too perfect, too smooth. Stay put, I say, even though my legs are ready to bolt. O'Brien, record this. Command will want to... The thing in front of us suddenly pauses. It turns its head in our direction. A little too far, and smiles with a black, empty mouth. Contact! Lewis yells as the figures lurch forward, moving faster than anything should ever move. Gunfire reverberations through the night. The bullets go right through the wraiths, but they keep coming. One of them reaches the fence and passes through it like it was made of smoke. Reverse! Reverse! I yell, changing the Humvee into gear. Base! This is Miller. We have multiple breaches. I repeat... Something slams into the side of the car. Through the windshield, I see a face, my own face, looking in and smiling at me. Drive, 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 O'Brien shouts, unloading his mag into the windshield. The glass spiders hold, and the thing that looks like me slides off. I press the accelerator all the way to the floor, and we back up, tires spinning in the muck, away from the base. More of them are coming out of the shade of just in phase and tap the darkness now. Some crawling, some walking. My radio buzzes one more time. It's Bravo team. All of them, speaking as one. We are coming home, Captain. We are all coming home. The base is visible up ahead, but it looks much further away than it should be. And something is following us. Those things that looked like us are bringing with them a deep, abiding silence and a feeling of dread and doom that goes beyond anything I can put into words. It's like the end of everything we ever hoped for, the end of the world as we know it. The cut on my arm is still there, and I can feel something moving beneath my skin, burrowing deeper and deeper. Several harrowing minutes passed as we tore through the thick jungle darkness. The Humvee's engine roaring in protest as we navigated the treacherous terrain. The base disappeared into the night behind us, but the memory of those things still burned in our minds. Each bump and swerve sent waves of pain through my infected arm, the invasion beneath my skin spreading with every passing second. We needed to reach civilization, or what was left of it. The Humvee's tires squealed as I put the pedal to the floor, and we drove away from that thing that looked just like me. 2 kilometers to the village, Dutch says from behind me. The wound on my arm was pulsing, but I tried to ignore it. Movement, 10 o'clock, Louis shouts, aiming his rifle at an unseen enemy. Don't shoot unless you have to. We don't want to waste the bullets. Yeah, O'Brien barks. The bullets were so useful last time. I reached the village, but something was off. It was too dark. Jesus Christ, Dutch mutters as we get near. The gate was ripped off its hinges. The buildings were destroyed. Those same fractal patterns were found everywhere. Contact, Louis calls out. People are alive. I see figures moving towards us through the rain. It's Bravo team, but why are they walking funny? Wait here, I say, stopping the Humvee. Let's make sure it's them first. One of them lifts an arm in the air, waving. Captain Miller. It sounds like Sergeant Hayes from Bravo team, but his voice is off, like he's reading a line that he doesn't understand. Code word, I say into the radio. There's a 3-second delay of static, then Sierra, Echo 7. O'Brien grips his gun. That's yesterday's code word, sir. Niner, the voice continues, crackling. Teen. It came closer, and in the light I could see its face. It looked like Hayes, but as if I were seeing him through a frosted window. Open fire, I yell as the creature in Hayes's skin starts to sprint, limbs contorting the wrong way, feet floating above the floor. Gunfire rings out, and I see more figures coming out of the rubble. Some of them are wearing Bravo team's faces. Others are half-formed. Go! 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 I shout, throwing the Humvee into drive, speeding off as a body splatters against the back window. Actual survivors, 3 o'clock, Dutch shouts, in front of the mosque. I looked over and saw some real soldiers, or at least they looked like real soldiers, but they weren't moving with that terrifying fluid grace. Instead, they were moving frantically, as if they were terrified of something. Covering fire, I shout, spinning the Humvee around so that it's between the survivors and the maniacs. Get them in the car. O'Brien and Dutch jump out of the truck and begin to run through the rain. I stay behind, watching the darkness through the thermal optics. Sir, Lewis's voice breaks. The scars, sir, the scars. The survivors, Dutch and O'Brien, are half-carrying, have the same branching wounds we do, but theirs have spread further, turning their skin into a roadmap of red lines that pulse with an inner light. Quick, bring them in. There is a shriek in the distance, and a moment later, something comes out of the remains of the mosque. It looks like an animated, metallic smoke, constantly changing its body in an unnatural way. It has eyes, and they're the same color as the patterns on our skin. What is that thing? One of the soldiers asks, gasping for air. Whoever knows is dead, O'Brien replies, pulling the final soldier into the van. It looks at us, and I can feel it trying to get into my head. Captain, Dutch's voice is calm but strained. The shapes on the floor, they're expanding, increasing. He was right. The veins were coming out of the ground, heading towards us, and wherever they touched, the earth changed. Light! One of the survivors suddenly screams. They hate the light! I turned on the high beams as one of them was about to grab the Humvee. For a moment, I saw what the creature looked like, or perhaps I simply saw a reflection of what my mind thought it looked like. Strange formations that looked like a cave of non-Euclidean geometry. It took a step back, revealing its true body, then ran away. All right, everyone, torches out, I command. Circle 'em! The lights repelled the shapes, but only temporarily. This will only keep them for a short while, Lewis says, lighting another one of the things as it changes. Long enough, I say, starting the truck. Hang on! We sped out of the village, our headlights illuminating the night. In the rearview mirror, I saw the things joining together, becoming something huge and amorphous, stretching out a hand towards us. The radio crackles. Ah, coming home. I turn it off and pay attention to the road, trying to ignore the throbbing pain of the cut on my arm and the sound of music playing in the back of my mind. Ah, my arm. It's spreading faster. One of the soldiers we picked up sputters. We'll be at the base in 5 minutes, I add. But I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing. I notice the rain is still falling, and I wonder if it's spelling out more words. And if it is, what is it saying and who's it meant for? Me or something else? The lights of the base are just up ahead, but it still feels like we're completely surrounded by the darkness. "Mr. Sir," Dutch whispers to me, "check out the sky." And up in the sky, the stars are moving, rearranging themselves to body new constellations. The cut on my arm throbs one last time, and I think I hear it say my name. We pulled into the base as the moving stars disappeared behind storm clouds. Armed guards waved us through security checkpoints while medics rushed to meet our convoy. The strange phenomena that had followed us through the wilderness seemed to evaporate under the harsh fluorescent lights and military efficiency, leaving only the steady drum of rain on metal roofs. After a brief but intense debrief with command, we prepared to head back out. A few minutes later, the gates were closing behind us and we were back on the road. I turned off the ignition and we all sat in the dark for a few seconds, catching our breath. "Medics are on the way," O'Brien croaks. He looks down at his hands, clutching his rifle. I see paramedics approaching with stretchers, and everything looks normal. Too normal. "Anyone injured, take them to the triage center," I say, stepping into the rain. "Everyone else, weapons check and report on the double." He was laughing and crying at the same time as they carted him away. "They wore their faces, sir," he murmurs as we walk by. "They wore their faces and smiled." Dutch is by my side, as always, and I find his presence soothing, though disturbing in its own way. "Six men. We lost six men out there." "At least six," I respond as Peterson is led into the medical building. "Who knows how many more?" Major Gallagher walks back over to us. The rain pours down on him. "My office. Now," he says, walking away. We walk in silence. The darkness seems to be closing in from outside. "Well?" Gallagher asks after shutting his office door. I tell him what I saw as clearly as I can, but how do you describe impossible geometry? How do you quantify terror? "The thermal scans?" he asks when I'm done. "No good. The signatures were different." Gallagher clenches his jaw. "And the replicas?" "Identical, sir. Just didn't move right. And the eyes?" I glance at my shoulder. "They looked like us, but it wasn't us." "Wearing us," he mutters under his breath. "Sir," he meets my gaze. "This is to be marked classified, level echo. Tell your squad what they need to know, and nothing about what you saw." "Sir, I think they should be aware. That's an order, Captain." He dismisses me, but I can see it in his eyes. "You're free to go." The briefing room is silent. My colleagues look tired and traumatized. "Report has been made," I say to everyone. "Command has been notified." "Nay." "Notified?" O'Brien laughs. "Notified like Echo Base was notified? Notified like Kareem's Village was notified?" "We're told what we need to know," I reply. "The party line is, we experienced insurgent activity with unknown chemical weapons." Louis scratches at the dressing on his arm where the patterns have begun to extend. "And what aren't they saying?" And then a question. In the corner of my eye, I saw something moving outside the window, but it was probably just someone guarding the house. "Unofficially," I say slowly. "We observe, we record, and we monitor." "For what?" Dutch asks in a hushed tone. "For things that don't cast the right shadow." An hour later, I get the medical report. It turns out the patterns on Peterson's skin have grown. They now cover 60% of his body. The other survivors have the same problem. The doctors don't know what to make of it. I don't envy them. How do you explain something like that? I watch the rain from my window, thinking about everything that has happened. The wound on my arm is throbbing. I look at my reflection in the glass. I wonder if it's really me I'm seeing, or if it's just a mask made of skin. The radio is still on, and the static is still there, but I can hear something else now, buried beneath the noise. It's faint, but it's there, like a whisper from another world. It sounds like a melody, like a song, like a lullaby. The rain clouds are clearing, and I can see the stars again. They twinkle in the night sky, like the eyes of a thousand children. I can't help but smile, even though I don't understand why. There's something beautiful about it, something soothing, something familiar. It's as if the stars are trying to tell me a secret that only I can hear. I turn off the radio and close my eyes. I listen to the silence. I listen to the stars. I listen to the lullaby. I listen to the voices in my head. I listen to the monsters outside. I listen to the monsters inside. I listen to the monsters that are us. I listen to the monsters that are me, and I wonder, what did we really see out there? The stars faded into memory as dawn approached, giving way to another sleepless night. Weeks passed, then months, the questions still burning inside me. I couldn't let it go, not after what we'd seen. I did what any desperate person would do. I started digging. The military databases became my new battlefield, each encrypted file a potential answer to the mysteries that haunted my dreams. And now, sitting in my study in the early hours of morning, I finally had something concrete to chase. It was raining when we were in Afghanistan, at least that's how I remember it, the constant sound of raindrops hitting the roof of the Humvee, the strange patterns forming on the windshields. I have a picture from that day before everything went wrong. 7 men in army fatigues. 3 of us came back home. There's a scar on my arm which branches out like a tree. They tell me it's a keloid, but I know that's not true. The dim glow of a laptop screen illuminates my study. It's 3 in the morning, and I'm combing through yet another confidential database that I'm not supposed to have access to. O'Brien's retirement gift, his bundle of passwords and backdoors, has been incredibly useful. "Got you," I mutter as I open a file marked Echo 7 Anomalous Incidents. My phone vibrated in my pocket. Dutch was calling me. "You're not still researching, are you?" he asks. "You should be resting." "So should you, Captain." I can't help but laugh. "Not a captain anymore, Dutch." A captain to me, and to all of us who returned, though. "Dutch, these reports. They were aware. It happened before. Kazakhstan in 89, Chile in 93, and... oh my God." I sent him the file and he went quiet for a few minutes. "Thomas," he says finally, first name, "these patterns, they're the same." Not just the patterns, the time inconsistencies, the duplicate crew members, the star paths, all of it. "File's gone," Dutch says suddenly. I refreshed the screen. Error 404. My hands begin to tremble. "They're watching me," I say. "They've been watching for a long time." "You need to stop this, sir. You really do." I glance back at the picture, the real haze. "I can't. You know I can't." Dutch sighs. "Lewis called yesterday. Says his scar's been bugging him. Been feeling warm." My own scar tingles. "The anniversary's coming up." "That's not what I mean, sir. He says he's been hearing things in the static again. The hairs on my neck stand on end." A streetlight outside my window blinks on and off. "I'll call you back," I say, and hang up before Dutch can answer. My printer begins to print something out, although I didn't tell it to. I walk over to it and see that it's our original mission briefing from that night. But in between the lines of text, there is additional information, coordinates, radio frequencies, and snippets of code. None of it makes sense to me. The streetlight goes out. I can feel the heat from my scar again. My laptop screen flickers and glitches, showing strange symbols that look like the ones we saw in the village. My phone rings again. "Good evening?" Static. But beneath the static was that music. "Who is this?" "Coming home," the voice in my head answers, not from the receiver. "All of us, coming home." The line is dead again. My screen turns back to normal. Outside, the streetlight comes back on. I grab the printed pages. The strange text is gone, but I remember the coordinates. Of course I remember them. They're burned into my memory, just like the patterns were burned into our skin. I call Dutch. "I need you to pack a bag," I say when he picks up. "Get Lewis. There's something I want to show you." "Where?" I look at the picture one more time and at our shadows again, where it all began, where they are. "Are you certain?" My fingers already touch the warm scar on my forehead. Up in the sky, the stars are moving. "They were waiting," I say. "I don't think they're waiting anymore." There was a long pause, and then Dutch said, "I'll call Lewis. Tell me when we're leaving." And maybe I saw my reflection smile at me with a face that wasn't my own. "As soon as you can," I reply, glancing at the growing shadow on my floor.